Dr. Adeli is the Director of Educational Outreach for the University of Arizona's Center for Middle Eastern Studies since July 2007. She has also taught in high schools for more than 12 years, well acquainted with what is asked of our teachers today and how those things can be accomplished. As CMES Director of Educational Outreach, her goal is to provide teachers with accurate information on the Middle East, professional development opportunities both in the United States and abroad, and materials that educators can use in their classrooms. And she is going to be doing just that in our History Changed Us webinar series with three webinars about World War I and the Middle East. And today she's going to be discussing social history. So Dr. Adeli, thank you so much for being with us today.
Well, thank you for having me. I'm just trying to, get back so I can share my screen with you. So, all right. So you guys can see it, right? Do you have it?
Yes, we do.
Okay, good. All right. So by academic background, I'm a historian. I'm really interested in education. In addition to being a former teacher, I still volunteer teach or part-time teach Middle East studies, dual credit class, so at a high school. Anyway, today I'd like to talk about social history of the Middle East. I think social history is really exciting, and especially because it's not always what's covered when people are talking about a war. It's not all about the battlefields and the diplomacy. And actually, World War I in the Middle East, it was arguably the most important turning point in Middle Eastern history. And today, talking about the social history of it and the effects of the Ottoman Empire and, on the Ottoman Empire, on soldiers and civilians, but on people, I think is really important. So let's get started with this. Just a second. There we go. The plan for the session, you've already heard from Cherie, so I'll go on. There is a map here, and I'm not sure if you can see my cursor, but if you look at, you can see the Ottoman Empire here. By the, just before World War I, the Ottoman Empire was the purple and pink and orange and yellow. By the time World War II began in 1914, it was just the yellow and the orange parts you see on this map. So you can see that the empire has shrunk a lot. You can also see that it has a very important strategic location straddling the whole eastern side of the Mediterranean. So when we're talking about the Ottoman Empire, we're talking about Turkey and the Arab lands at this point. You can see we're not going to talk about why and how the war broke out and everything. That's for a different webinar. But the Ottoman Empire declared war. They're forced into it, but that's just a preview of coming discussion. In October 1914, they joined on the side of the Central Powers. And as you can see when you look at this map, look at the red right down the middle. You see why they're called the Central Powers. And the Ottoman Empire, which is toward the bottom right side of the map, played an important part in splitting, France and Britain and the US and everybody from Russia. And you can also see by looking at this map that the Ottoman Empire is fighting a war on a whole lot of fronts. They're going to be fighting north against Russia. They're going to be fighting to the east, the northeast, against northwest, sorry, I do know my directions, the northwest in the Straits area against Britain and France, and then also all along in the coastal area and through Egypt, which is to the southwest of the Ottoman Empire. Now, when we look at social issues of the war, I think it's really important to talk about the effects of the war on the troops, you know, on those people, because, you know, that had a lasting impact on Ottoman society. First of all, it's important to note that World War I in the West, we think of from the middle of 1914 to the end of 1918, that's 4.5 years. But if you were an Arab or a Turk or anybody involved in the Ottoman Empire, World War I is part of what they would consider one long war from 1910 to 1923. And that's 13 long years. From when they're putting down revolts in Yemen and some other places to the Balkan Wars, going right into World War I, and after the war, fighting over the peace settlements. You know, the Turkish War of Liberation was the last chapter in World War I. So think about what effects this was going to have on a soldier. You know, I mean, 13 years of your life if you survived. All the people you've lost, the psychological impact, being separate from your family. Think of All Quiet on the Western Front, that instead of 2 years, you have 13 years in there, okay? So it had a very big impact. There were a lot of casualties. Just considering the World War I segment of that long war alone, at least 770,000 troops were killed in battle. Many others were wounded or died of disease. We'll talk about disease. And medical care was not that great back then. So, you know, you could get an infection. There weren't antibiotics. You know, you could lose a leg and be permanently disabled. Also, the treatment of POWs was an issue because the British, especially, took a lot of POWs. And they had this idea that Ottomans were somehow you know, it's the Orientalist thinking, that these Easterners didn't require the same nutrient-rich diet that the rest of us did. And so basically, they starved the troops, thinking that they were allowed to do this because they were non-Western. And so a lot of people had lasting impact on the POW experience because of that, and also because of other disease thing. We can talk about that at a little bit later point. And you can see that this is going to have a long-term impact on society, because you have people with PTSD, even if they didn't call it that back then, they called it shell shock. You're going to have a lot of people who are wounded and disabled and ill because of their experience. The Ottomans also, just wanted to show you, the people who experienced the war as soldiers experienced it in a variety of different ways. Now, these are Ottoman soldiers in Gallipoli, and which is, you know, in the northwestern part of the Ottoman Empire. And you could see typical trench warfare. It's what you might expect. What you might not expect is when the Ottomans fought against the Russians to the north, they often fought up to their waist in snow, or sometimes on skis, like these troops you see here. If you were down farther down, like near Arabia and in Egypt and Palestine in that area, you would see this Lawrence of Arabia kind of view. Fighting on camels and in the desert. So there were a lot of different kinds of experiences with the war, and this, I believe, is Egypt. So there were also, you know, if you want to look at the Ottoman experience, you have to look at what happened in the Ottoman home front. And we're good at talking about that when we talk about the West, but sometimes we're not so good about that when we talk about other people, as if the war revolves around us. So usually when you talk about the Middle East and World War I, people are talking about peace treaties and stuff that was done to them by the British and French. But that's a very Western-centered view. From the Ottoman view, there were a lot of issues on the home front. you know, that would have been the major thing that they're thinking about. I mean, as well as the well-being of the soldiers they know who are fighting. First of all, there was one of the main problems on the home front was famine. And if you were to ask anybody from Syria, Lebanon, Palestine, what is, you know, the memory of World War I? What is the thing that your area experienced most of World War I? They would all talk about famine. And people debate why this occurred in Lebanon and Syria. They like to think that it was just because the Ottomans weren't efficient in letting the food get through, but that wasn't totally it. Part of it was, yeah, the food was going to troops and families were starving. Part of it was troops were marching through and there happened to be a plague of locusts. We'll talk about that soon. I mean, could it get worse, right? Sort of like now in our history. There were enemy blockades, though, which often isn't considered, that the British blockade of ports, like going into Lebanon and everything, that made sure that there was no grain shipments getting in, so that when they did have a plague of locusts and all of that, that, you know, food wasn't getting in. And less people farming because men are away fighting and people are fleeing the battlefield. And then you also get starvation because of forced population movements. And I'm thinking of genocide, the Armenian genocide in particular, but other, you know, movements of population. So starvation was a real big issue and probably the number one issue if you ask anybody in, as I said, in Syria and Lebanon. Another problem on the Ottoman home front are, you know, and every home front that of an area where there's war being fought on their territory is disease. And it's really important to realize that war and disease go together. And a lot of times more people will die of disease than of war. I mean, in the Balkan Wars, for example, typhus was a big issue. Typhoid and cholera spread by contaminated water. Think of people marching around. They're not taking porta potties with them, right? This is getting into the water supply. There's typhus spread by lice. The Ottoman troops have been fighting it since the Balkan Wars in 1912 and 13. So 1914, it just is continuing over new territory. And it doesn't just stay with the troops. Those lice get everywhere. In fact, a huge percentage of the Serbian population, civilian population, died of typhus during the Balkan Wars. And many, many civilians in the Middle East died during World War I of the same thing. At the very end of the war, there was influenza, of course, the pandemic. And again, it's not like war caused this disease to occur, but all the troops moving around, that increases it. Another problem of the Ottoman home front is locusts. And we're not talking about, oh, this is annoying bugs being around. We're talking about them devastating everything in their path. Clouds, so that you couldn't even see, that it day looked like night because there were so many of them. And to the point that often the Ottomans had to stop the fighting, like in Palestine, there were times that they would just totally stop all troop movements and everything and send the troops out to gather up locusts because they had to kill them and keep people from starving, right? Then there's unrest and persecution in different places, or rebellions in a number of different places, including there were rebellions of some Armenians in Turkey. There were rebellions in other places too, Iraq, for example. And then there's the Armenian genocide of 1915. This is the first modern genocide. I mean, you know, a real systematic, well-organized, coming from a government attempt to kill a lot of people. And if you know anything about genocide, you understand that war is linked to it, or fear of war sometimes, like in Rwanda. But you know, that people are afraid and out of fear do some horrific and unconscionable things. Between 1 and 1.5 million Armenians were killed, often troops, and they were usually troops of Turkish and Kurdish origin, who would round up in areas that they considered sensitive, like in Turkey mostly. This didn't happen in Iraq so much. It was the Kurds of northeastern Turkey, because of this fear that being Christians, they would join with the Ottomans, with the Russians, against them. And of course, the Russians had stirred up a lot of stuff among the Kurds, among the Armenians. But first they gathered up the men and killed a lot of them outright. Women and children were often gathered up a little bit later, a few days, weeks later, and marched across Turkey into the Syrian desert, which, let's face it, very few people were going to survive that. They died of exposure, they died of disease, they died of starvation. Just a real terrible chapter in World War I history. And you can see a picture here of soldiers in an Armenian village. You see all the skulls. And the absolute destruction. Also, another factor that played into the home front was Allied policy during World War I. They supported Arab revolt against the Ottoman Empire. And, we'll see when we talk about the diplomatic stuff what role that played. But the revolt also, of course, involved a lot of local people. And, ended up with many of the Ottoman troops who were recruited from among the Arabs, ended up questioning being part of the empire and eventually revolting. The long-term social impact of the war, and you can't, a war when it ends, in the United States, and our students are products of this, they're used to thinking of the war ending, the troops come home, everything ended in 1918. But that's not true in most parts of the world, because you have these continuing impacts in the place where you are living. So you have the reintegration of returning soldiers, many with PTSD or physical illnesses and disabilities. And in fact, some of those that were in the British internment camps, some people had come from a small rural area in Turkey where they had an eye disease that was very strictly limited to a small rural region, that caused blindness. But some of the troops had it. The British concentrated them in a small space. A lot of them ended up going home blind and then spreading that throughout the countryside. So that's a long-term impact. You have displaced people. The survivors among the Armenians, they're all over the place. Some of them stayed in Jerusalem permanently and places like that. You have children who are orphaned or whose mothers could not care for them because of the war. And I'll show you in a lesson plan where there are some really cool primary sources about that. About the experience of children who lost parents or whose parents were unable to care for them because the war financially devastated them or left the woman without any means of support. So you have that. And then the memory of starvation and suffering and who they blame for that. So really quickly, there are two lessons that specifically involve the social history of World War I in the Middle East. One of them is exclusively on the social history. The other involves that among other things. Both are active learning lessons. Both get students working with documents and materials they wouldn't have encountered in other classes. A lot of the documents that the kids are getting from World War I and in all the other classes they take will be mostly Western-centered. So it's kind of neat to hear some new voices. Both are significant because the Middle Eastern front is very neglected. People just don't talk about it as much as they do the others. It's where, as I mentioned, World War I lasted the longest, and where it has had a really long, long ongoing impact, which I'll talk about, especially in the August 13th webinar. So of these two lessons, the first one is with analyzing primary source documents. And you can see the link there. I think Cherie said she would send it out after this webinar if you need it, or you can always email me to get the link. But what this lesson is there are writing prompts either for a long DBQ with three parts to your traditional essay. I also taught English, by the way. Or three sets of short primary documents on three different issues. You could have students, just to take one or two class periods max, and have students do any one of the three experience, civilians experience, soldiers experience, the effect on public health, you know, and how war and disease go together. And so there are these three sets of very short documents and photos and stuff. And students can work with them. There's a document analysis sheet, which kind of helps them think about who wrote it, why they wrote it, or who took the photo, what the point of it was, and ask questions like that. And so students can take one of them and then write a short thing or give a presentation or do whatever you want with it. So again, you can make it a longer DBQ, or if you're just, you don't have that much time, you can, do something much shorter. Especially if you get the kids to share their, what they've learned with kids who are in different, you know, who read different sets of documents. Included is also an optional overview of World War I in the Middle East that you can print and hand out to the kids or use for your own knowledge or whatever you want. And here's some examples. So here's an example of one of the photos. I think this is interesting because it's the Red Crescent Society. Have the kids look up why they call it Red Crescent instead of Red Cross. And that's a really interesting discussion right there because, you know, when was the last time in history that Westerners marched around wearing white clothes with a red cross on it and murdered a bunch of civilians? I mean, that was the Crusades, right? And so Red Cross doesn't have a good connotation. Neither does Crusade, by the way. And so that's something interesting to look up, and also the whole technology and the way, you know, who is in the picture and everything like that. And then there are a bunch of short writings. I found some really cool diaries and things. This one is from a Palestinian Arab who was stationed in Jerusalem, where he was from, as a young Ottoman army officer. And he talks about the spread of disease. And when he talks about it, the last line on this part of the quote, "I love life and enjoy its offerings. Please God, I'm still young. Do not take me away." You know, you read this, 105 years later, you still go, oh my, you know? And there are interesting things. The other lesson is World War I in the Middle East, and it's a museum project. I'm a big believer in, you know, making kids do a project and inviting other people to see it. You'd be surprised at how accountable they are when they know that their peers and their parents and other people are gonna see this. So what it is there's ways for the students to research a project, and I included a list of Middle Eastern topics and approaches so that they could make a museum, like in your school libraries where I used to always do it. And they create an exhibit, or you can even have documentaries or sometimes I have them, they wanted to do their exhibit through a PowerPoint, and the library computers all have them like running on a loop. And the library had small rooms where they could show the documentaries. And then they share it. And the more you invite people, the better it is. And you can team with other classes. So let's say your students do World War I in the Middle East, and somebody else, maybe an English teacher, will say, oh, I'd like to do that, and I'll do something, my students reading All Quiet on the Western Front. Plus we can do some British war poetry and stuff like that. And the French class can say, oh, I want to do one on France in World War I. And the US history, you know, US history class can do it on US in World War I. And you can make a museum. And then you invite everybody. And when I used to do this at Buena High School, it was cool because it's a small town, so nothing much happens. And the newspaper covers everything. And they did like a full spread and everything. And man, let me tell you, those students, they cared about their projects because people were coming to look. In this lesson, there's a how-to description. There's background reading that you can hand out to people. There's a list of projects and a list of resources where they can get started looking to find cool stuff for their projects, because it's hard. I mean, to find stuff on the Middle East, it's not as easy as finding it on other places. So I made a list. And then there's a museum viewing assignment, because you invite all the classes in your school, you know, people can sign up to bring their groups to the library, but so I made a museum viewing assignment that the teacher can choose. And I noticed most of the teachers will do that, will print it out, give it out to their students and say, okay, so you're not just going and wandering around aimlessly. You better engage with at least a couple of these projects and write this up because you're getting graded. And so students work hard if you invite people. And one of my students was quoted in the newspaper saying, I worked really hard on this, but I got a lot of attention for doing it. Because what is it a high school student wants is they want this attention. And kids who do the positive stuff are real quick to point out to you, they don't get as much of it as they deserve. The attention usually goes to, you know, if somebody calls a bomb threat into a school, it's going to be covered by the papers, but are they going to get as much attention for doing some great academic work? Not usually. This is a way to do it. And that's all I have. So if you have any questions, or, you know, you can always contact me. We'll do some questions live now. But if you think of anything, contact me. Or if you wanted to, I have a weekly e-bulletin, you know, listserv, where I put out opportunities and resources for teachers. If you and I put out anything that's internationally themed. So I just can't keep up with all the US only stuff. But if you want to find out a lot of cool stuff that's going around, you know, that's going on, grants you can get, programs you could participate in, just shoot me an email and say you want to be on it. And tell me if you're from Arizona or not from Arizona, or if you're a college teacher or a K-12 teacher, because I have three different listeners, depending on your answers to those questions. So, okay. So let me stop sharing the screen somehow. And how do I stop sharing? Huh. Oh, here we go. Pause share. All right. So does anybody have any questions? I still don't think I see the chat.
It looks like we've got a couple of questions that came up. The first comes from Janine asking, what proportion of the Ottoman military was made up of Arab conscripts?
I'm afraid I don't know the answer to that question. I do know that the Ottomans didn't make any differentiation between by this point, they probably were between non-Muslim and Muslim populations, but whether you were a Turk or a Kurd or an Arab, you were equally subject to conscription. And in fact, even if you were part of the, what was then a small Jewish minority actually living in Palestine, you could be conscripted too. I have a diary by one of those. So it would have been, you know, a lot of the men would have been conscripted in some way. All right, sorry, I don't have an exact number.
Oh. A question from Crystal who asks, do you have any specific information about how soldiers were reintegrated after they returned?
I don't think there was any particular thing. They were just kind of sent home. And even if they were sent home, you know, because they were demobilized or, and of course the Turkish ones ended up just staying in and fighting the War of Independence because they didn't like the peace treaty from World War I. But, you know, so there wasn't a lot of effort to reintegrate. And in fact, there was something I forgot to mention, and that reminded me. When they came home, well, they were really welcomed in the Turkish countryside, especially because, not just because, of course, you're glad to have your people home, but so many people died in the wars that the women outnumbered men 5-1 in parts of the Anatolian countryside, you know, that part of Turkey in the middle, the rural part of Turkey. And of course, you need men for the agricultural work and everything, and you need men to marry the women, because otherwise, what can the women do? And which I thought was really interesting, because after Turkey transforms into the Turkish Republic under Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, he made it so that women could only, he wanted to improve the status of women for really good reasons, right? But he made a law outlawing polygamy, which was a good thing, except consider that after World War I, in the Anatolian countryside, there are 5 women for every 1 man. And that if women don't get married, it's not like here now, you know, 2020, the US, or we could say, we don't get married, doesn't matter. We can have a job, we can do something else. That's not the case with people. Then women didn't have an education. They couldn't just go somewhere else. They were forced to rely on some male relative that could support them. And there weren't as many of those left. And so interestingly enough, what happened is a lot of times men, you know, by Islam, they can marry up to 4 women, as long as they could support them and the children, you know, that come from the marriage. And so a lot of times they would register the first marriage with the government and then register some other marriages with the mosque. And it wasn't until there was something like 8 million illegitimate children in Turkey that they went, okay, well, we'll grandfather in this arrangement, and realized that because of the World War I situation that it continued longer than we wanted. But that was one lasting impact of the war on the countryside, is that there were a lot of men missing and women trying to, you know, find their place in a society that's changing. So I don't know. So how they were reintegrated, as I said, you know, there's this transition government anyway. I don't think there was any systematic effort to do it. It was just, oh, thank God you're home.
We also have a question from Amanda. Could you speak to the role the Muslim religion played in the decision to join the Central Powers and in the war itself?
In the decision to join the Central Powers, I would say zero role, because they joined it because of geopolitics and because they were arm twisted into doing it. Russia was the big enemy, and if my enemy's enemy is my friend, of course, Germany. And plus, some of the Ottoman leaders had long contact with Germany anyway. Germany was building the railroads. It was just purely a political thing, because all the major combatants were Christians. If there was any role that religion played, it was that Russia stirred up trouble, in the Ottoman view, among the Christian minorities. They'd already lost all the Balkan minorities, and a lot of it because of Russian military intervention. And now Russia is kind of, you know, saying, well, we're going to protect the Armenians, and we think they should have special treatment. And so, you know, the Ottomans are getting afraid of Russia. Russia was their big threat in a lot of ways. And religion played sort of a sideways role in that, maybe as far as with the Armenians, during the war, of course, religion played a role because, you know, they couldn't hold the loyalty of the Christian, well, they did the Palestinian Christians, I mean, as much as they did the Palestinian Muslims, but with the Armenians, they began to distrust the Christians, and it wasn't real, well, I mean, genocide's never the fault of the people, in, you know, that were the victims, but in this case, it was really the fear, maybe in most genocides, the fear is overblown. And so the Ottomans were afraid the Armenians would rebel and therefore just absolutely reacted in a way all out of proportion. And then, well, if you visit the military museum in Istanbul, which is really a wonderful museum, man, when the Janissary band goes through playing and, you know, you just, what could be better than that? So, but what was interesting to me is they had a room on the Armenian atrocities. And I thought, wow, they've actually acknowledged what they did during World War I. This is interesting. And, but then that room, it turned out, was atrocities that, you know, maybe 20 Armenians committed against the whole Ottoman army.
Interesting.
So the whole narrative had been kind of, anyway. So that was probably the biggest role, but mostly it didn't have to do, I think at this point, with religion, because nationalism is spreading. Armenians weren't persecuted, I think, as Christians, they're persecuted as Armenians. And Palestinian Christians weren't treated differently than Palestinian Muslims. You know, they were just Arabs by this point, right? So, I don't know, maybe less than we would expect. Religion is sometimes a lot less of an issue than we expect. It's sometimes a marker of identity, of national identity or ethnic identity or something. It's not about religion per se, but usually something else. And I think during the war, the something else, you know, the nationalism kind of superseded any concern about religion. If that makes sense.
Excellent ideas that you talk about, and so many different facets that need to be considered when you look at this part of the world and what was going on. We have an really interesting question that I would love to get your take on. This question comes from Janine, who asks if you have ideas for making your museum project virtual.
Wow, that's yes. Such a great question, and one that I am ashamed to admit I hadn't thought of, because of course I developed this lesson before COVID-19,
right,
when all of us ended up going virtual. But I can imagine you could do that, because you could make, kids these days can do things like, you know, make simple movies, mm-hmm. Right? We all can. We've all learned how to do this. We're doing it now. You know, you can do PowerPoint kind of things. You could post exhibits online. And actually, with our roadmaps project, we have people who are posting those kind of visual things as part of their projects. And so, yeah, I think you could do it. And that would be a really fun thing to try.
Thank you. That's tough when it comes, you know, kind of on the fly, and you haven't had to think about teaching virtually. It is a whole new world, and it's fascinating what adaptations teachers are coming up with and being able to explore. It's mm-hmm. It's not easy, but it is an intriguing opportunity for folks to explore different ways that projects can be done.
And I like that, the way you put that, Cherie, too, is it is an opportunity. I mean, it's been hard. It's been hard for all of us, but it's an opportunity too. I mean, we wouldn't have been doing this if we hadn't right. been kind of forced into adapting our methods, or, you know, some of the most fun and creative stuff I've done in recent years, it's been because I've been locked into my house with COVID and cancer, so, you know, Are there any other questions?
There are. Here, let's take one from Mary. There's a great deal of tension between Turks and Kurds, at least that's what is reported in the media. Did that begin as a result of this war and the establishment of Turkey?
Excellent question, because during the war, during the course of the war itself, the Kurds and the Turks were really tight. And in fact, when you talk about Ottoman troops and the Armenian genocide, a lot of them were Kurdish too. You know, the troops were all, the Kurds were totally behind the Ottoman war effort. What happened, and we will see that in, I think, the next webinar, is with the diplomatic agreements that ended World War I, the original, originally there was the idea of creating Kurdistan, which should have happened, really, because they're today the largest group of people in the world without their own country. And that was overturned because of a lot of different political factors, and the Kurds ended up not getting a state. That's when they ended up having to, or feeling that they had to fight against Turkey and Iraq and Iran to a certain extent and Syria, because they were, left as minorities in nation states, which is different from being a minority in a multinational empire. So I think, in other words, just to sum up, that the tension between Turks and Kurds occurred at the very end of the war, over the settlement, rather than during the war, over the progress of it.
Interesting. We had a great comment from Janine, who said, off the top of my head, regarding a virtual museum, one could create a Padlet museum page for students to post their projects. So some great ideas coming in here. And I am going to take that opportunity to segue into a look that the National World War I Museum and Memorial offers in terms of some resources to assist folks who are teaching virtually. We know that lots of people, lots of districts around the nation are still making those decisions of exactly what the beginning of the 2020-2021 school year is going to look like, but it looks like in a lot of places it's either going to be a hybrid or it's going to be digital. And so, Lisa, can I have you, actually, I think that I can do this here.
Do you want me to exit some screen?
I think actually that I was able do this. Yeah. And I'm just going to show a few examples of things that we have to share from our website, which is theworldwar.org. Most of our resources that I think are going to interest people the most, if you come to our Learn tab, that's right there in the center, and then to educators and students, you'll see that we have a variety of different pages here. One that I think is going to be most valuable is our teaching resource database. And I'm gonna slip to the end where you can see that we partner with a great many different institutions from around the world. This isn't just materials that have been put together by our institution, but a lot of different partners. And the idea is that there are so many different resources that exist about World War I, and some of them are really wonderful, great things that teachers should be using, and we want to encourage that. We kind of think of this as a one-stop shop, if you will, where you can come in. It is searchable, so you can search by grade level, by subject, by the type of resource that you are looking for, and be able to access all of those here. And one of the great things is that within our lesson plans that you will find there, there are several that were done by Dr. Adeli, and you can access those right there. You can also find from that educators and students page more information about understanding the Great War. This is an e-newsletter that comes out bi-monthly, so every other month, you can access these wonderful newsletters. They're always based around a theme. And again, the idea is to provide variety of resources that you can check out. And if you have missed some, not a problem, because all of our past issues are archived and accessible here from this page. We also have, and I point these out to you not because we don't think that you don't know how to use a website, but because sometimes some of these pieces can get lost and be a little bit difficult to find. Another thing that I highly recommend is the About World War I section, where different experts, including our own curators, have written content, but it is paired with video from the period, photographs, different interactives, as well as some deeper sections on some of those personalities or some of those subtopics that you may be interested in having students look at, especially if you are doing a flipped classroom or if you are looking for some general content. That is a wonderful place for students to access. And if you come over to Explore and down to Online Collections Database, you're going to see where you can have students begin to explore our online collections. Over 40,000 different pieces, whether they be photographs, posters, journals, documents, letters. You're going to find more than 40,000 of these. Here, you can access them with just a keyword search and find some really tremendous primary sources for your students to use. I'm going to, I thought it would be easier to do this, not through the PowerPoint, but to actually show you where you can look. But I also want to remind everyone about other examples that are going to be coming up in our webinar series. This is going to be done on Tuesdays and Thursdays, running through the end of August. We'll switch to a once a week format when we hit September. That'll run through November. But on Thursday, Dr. Jennifer Zobeline is going to be examining Coming Home, which is very interesting, as Dr. Adeli spoke today about what that process was like. We'll be looking at it on Thursday about the American experience and what that was like here. And then, as Dr. Adeli mentioned, she's going to be so kind and generous with her time to do an additional two webinars with us here at the National World War I Museum and Memorial. The first will be a diplomatic history of World War I in the Middle East. That's going to be on Tuesday, July 28th. And then on Thursday, August 13th, it will be the enduring legacy of World War I on the Middle East today. And always, those begin at 3 p.m. Central Time, and they run for about an hour. Now, Dr. Adeli, do you have any comments that you would like to share? We are running up on about an hour. We can extend it. Certainly, if folks have more questions for us.
I don't know if anything else, if you don't.
Okay, let's take a look and see what other questions that we have. And before we do this, I will let you know that you're going to receive an email from us, from the museum here in the next few days. And that is going to include links to those resources that Dr. Adeli shared. In addition, there's going to be a link to a survey. Grant funding is what allows us to present these webinars. Ours come to us through the generous offering of the United States World War I Centennial Commission. And it is great for them to be able to see who it is that's participating and what your thoughts about these programs are. So we would love it if you could take a few minutes to complete that survey. You are also going to see a link that will take you to a printable or shareable professional development certificate that recognizes the hour of time that you spent with us. And that is going to be password protected. The password that you will need to remember for that is social21, S-O-C-I-A-L 21. And so all of that information will come to you in an email over the next few days. So Dr. Adeli, I want to thank you for everything today. And we do have a few more questions. So we'd love for you to stick around with us if you're unable to. That's okay, but for those of you that can, let's see about a few more questions, if you don't mind.
That's good.
Okay. How about this question from Amanda, who asks, you mentioned how British treated POWs. Did the Ottomans take POWs, and how did they treat them?
You know, that's really interesting, and I have at the Middle East Studies Association, I've been to a couple presentations on how Ottoman POWs were treated, but I've never seen anything on how they treated others. So I don't really know about that. Maybe, I don't know. Maybe they didn't have as many. I mean, being on the side that eventually lost the war, so.
We have a question that comes from Paul. Were there any particular internal social changes that allowed Turkey to successfully establish itself post-1918 as opposed to the failures 1914, 1918, or earlier?
So for Turkey to become a republic and an independent country, I think World War I, I mean, the fact that the Ottoman Empire was destroyed, I mean, what you have left is Turkey. I mean, of course, it was a divided up Turkey, but that then there was such a nationalist reaction against that, that I think that the reaction against the peace treaty, the Treaty of Sevres, was what allowed Turkey to successfully establish a republic. I mean, you know, if you think that all the previous institutions were wiped out, that, you know, it left room for something new. And the Turkish Republic went out of its way to make a break and create something new. I mean, when you think about it, they not just changed the form of government and that they became a republic instead of an empire, and that their territory was just Turkey instead of something larger. You know, they also took away the religious underpinning of the state. They changed the capital city from Istanbul to Ankara. You know, they made a real attempt to separate themselves with the Ottoman Empire. And I think that only could have happened because it, you know, they were on the losing side of the war. So.
Do we have any more questions from participants? I'm going to check very quickly to make sure that none popped up in the webinar chat area. Well, Dr. Adeli, you are so good that you were able to explain this very complicated look at World War I and the Middle East to the point that it looks like we don't have any further questions for today.
Well, thank you for having me.
We are so delighted for you to take the time to speak with us and with teachers and offering professional development. And we are very excited about the next webinar where you will join us, which I want to make sure I get the date correct, is Tuesday, July 28th. It'll be a 3 p.m. to 4 p.m. Central webinar time, and it's going to cover the diplomatic history of World War I in the Middle East. Again, I thank you so much for being with us. This program has been recorded, and we will make it available for viewing later this summer. Thank you so much, and I hope that you will be able to join us again soon.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.